Lesson 12, Occult Miscellany. In this, the last lesson of this series, we wish to call your attention to a variety of subjects, coming under the general head of the yogi philosophy, and yet apparently separated from one another. And so we have entitled this lesson Occult Miscellany, inasmuch as it is made up of bits of information upon a variety of subjects all connected with the general teaching of the series. The lesson will consist of answers to a number of questions asked by various students of the courses in yogi philosophy coming from our pen. While these answers, of necessity, must be brief, still we will endeavor to condense considerable information into each, so that read as a whole the lesson will give to our students a variety of information upon several important subjects. Question I. Are there any brotherhoods of advanced occultists in existence, in harmony with the yogi teachings? And if so, what information can you give regarding them? Answer. Yes, there are a number of occult brotherhoods, of varying degrees of advancement, scattered through the various countries of the earth. These brotherhoods agree in principle with the yogi teachings, although the methods of interpretation may vary somewhat. There is but one truth, which becomes apparent to all deep students of occultism, and therefore all true occultists have a glimpse of that truth, and upon this glimpse is founded their philosophies and teachings. These occult brotherhoods vary in their nature. In some, the members are grouped together in retired portions of the earth, dwelling in the community life. In others, the headquarters are in the large cities of the earth, their membership being composed of residents of those cities, with outlying branches. Others have no meeting places, their work being managed from headquarters, their members being scattered all over the face of the earth, the communication being kept up by personal correspondence and privately printed and circulated literature. Admission to these true occult brotherhoods is difficult. They seek their members, not the members them. No amount of money, or influence, or energy can gain entrance to these societies. They seek to impart formation and instruction only to those who are prepared to receive it, to those who have reached that stage of spiritual unfoldment that will enable them to grasp and assimilate the teachings of the inner circles. While this is true, it is also true that these societies or brotherhoods are engaged in disseminating occult knowledge, suited to the minds of the public, through various channels, and cloaked in various disguises of name, authority and style. Their idea is to gradually open the mind of the public to the great truths underlying and back of all of these various fragmentary teachings. And they recognize the fact that one mind may be reached in a certain way, and another mind in a second way, and so on. And, accordingly, they wrap their teachings in covers likely to attract the attention of various people, and to cause them to investigate the contents. But, under and back of all of these various teachings, is the great fundamental truth. It has often been asked of us how one might distinguish the real brotherhoods from the spurious ones which have assumed the name and general style of the true societies, for the purpose of exploiting the public, and making money from their interest in the great occult truths. Answering this, we would say that the true occult brotherhoods and societies never sell their knowledge. It is given free as water to those who seek for it, and is never sold for money. The true adept would as soon think of selling his soul as selling spiritual knowledge for gain. While money plays its proper place in the world, and the laborer is worthy of his hire, and while the masters recognize the propriety of the sale of books on occultism, providing the price is reasonable and not in excess of the general market price of books, and while they also recognize the propriety of having people pay their part of the expenses of maintaining organizations, magazines, lecturers, instructors, etc., still the idea stops there. It does not extend to the selling of the inner secrets of occultism for silver or gold. Therefore, if you are solicited to become a member of any so-called brotherhood or occult society for a consideration of money, you will know at once that the organization is not a true occult society, for it has violated one of the cardinal principles at the start. Remember the old occult maxim, when the pupil is ready, the master appears, and so it is with the brotherhoods and societies. If it is necessary for your growth, development, and attainment to be connected with one of these organizations, then, when the time comes when you are ready, you will receive your call, and then we'll know for a certainty that those who call are the true messengers of truth. Question 2. Are there any exalted human beings called masters, or adepts, or are the tales regarding them mere fables, etc.? Answer. Of a truth, there are certain highly developed, advanced and exalted souls in the flesh, known as masters and adepts, although many of the tales told concerning them are myths, or pure fiction originating in the minds of some modern sensational writers. And, moreover, these souls are members of the Great Lodge, an organization composed of these almost superhuman beings, these great souls that have advanced so very far on the path. Before beginning to speak of them, let us answer a question often asked by Western people, and that is, why do not these people appear to the world and show their powers? Each of you may answer that question from your own experiences. Have you ever been foolish enough to open your soul to the crowd and have it reveal the sacred truth that rests there? Have you ever attempted to impart the highest teachings known to you to persons who had not attained sufficient spiritual development to even understand the meaning of your words? Have you ever committed the folly of throwing spiritual pearls to material swine? If you have had these experiences, you may begin to faintly imagine the reasons of these illumined souls for keeping away from the crowd, for dwelling away from the multitude. No one who has not suffered the pain of having the vulgar crowd revile the highest spiritual truths to him can begin to understand the feelings of the spiritually illumined individuals. It is not that they feel that they are better or more exalted than the humblest man, for these feelings of the personality have long since left them. It is because they see the folly of attempting to present the highest truths to a public which is not prepared to understand even the elementary teachings. It is a feeling akin to that of the master of the highest musical conceptions attempting to produce his wonderful compositions before a crowd fit only for the ragtime and slangy songs of the day. Then again, these masters have no desire to work miracles which would only cause the public to become still more superstitious than they now are. When one glances back over the field of religions, and sees how the miraculous acts of some of the great leaders have been prostituted and used as a foundation for the grossest credulity and basest superstition, he may understand the wisdom of the masters in this respect. There is another reason for the non-appearance of the masters, and that is that there is no occasion for it. The laws of spiritual evolution are as regular, constant, and fixed as are the laws of physical evolution, and any attempt to unduly force matters only results in confusion, and the abortive results soon fade away. The world is not ready for the appearance of the masters. Their appearance at this time would not be in accordance with the plan. The masters or adepts are human beings who have passed from lower to higher planes of consciousness, thus gaining wisdom, power, and qualities that seem almost miraculous to the man of the ordinary consciousness. A Hindu writer speaking of them has said, "To him who hath traveled far along the path, sorrow ceases to trouble, fetters cease to bind, obstacles cease to hinder. Such an one is free. For him there is no more fever or sorrow. For him there are no more unconscious rebirths. His old karma is exhausted, and he creates no new karma. His heart is freed from the desire for future life. No new longings arise within his soul. He is like a lamp which burnt from the oil of the spirit, and not from the oil of the outer world." Lilly, in his work on Buddhism, tells his readers, "Six supernatural faculties were expected of the ascetic before he could claim the grade of Arhat." They are constantly alluded to in the suttas as the six supernatural faculties, usually without further specification. A broken bar in this transitory body, the intelligence of man is enchained. The ascetic, finding himself thus confused, directs his mind to the creation of manas. He represents to himself, in thought, another body created from this material body, a body with a form, members, and organs. This body in relation to the material body is like a sword and the scabbard, or a serpent issuing from a basket in which it is confined. The ascetic then, purified and perfected, begins to practice supernatural faculties. He finds himself able to pass through material obstacles, walls, ramparts, etc. He is able to throw his phantasmal appearance into many places at once. He acquires the power of hearing the sounds of the unseen world as distinctly as those of the phenomenal world, more distinctly in point of fact. Also, by the power of manas, he is able to read the most secret thoughts of others, and to tell their characters. These great masters are above all petty sectarian distinctions. They may have ascended to their exalted position along the paths of the many religions, or they may have walked the path of no denomination, sect, or body. They may have mounted to their heights by philosophical reasoning alone, or else by scientific investigation. They are called by many names, according to the viewpoint of the speaker, but at the last they are of but one religion, one philosophy, one belief, truth. The state of adeptship is reached only after a long and arduous apprenticeship extending over many lives. Those who have reached the pinnacle were once even as you who read these lines. And some of you, yes, perhaps even you who are now reading these words, may have taken the first steps along the narrow path which will lead you to heights equally as exalted as those occupied by even the highest of these great beings of whom we are speaking. Unconsciously to yourself, the urge of the Spirit has set your feet firmly upon the path, and will push you forward to the end. In order to understand the occult custom that finds its full fruit in the seclusion of the masters, one needs to be acquainted with the universal habit among true occultists of refraining from public or vulgar displays of occult power. While the inferior occultists often exhibit some of the minor manifestations to the public, it is a fact that the true advanced occultists scrupulously refrain from so doing. In fact, among the highest teachers, it is a condition imposed upon the pupil that he shall refrain from exhibitions of his developing powers among the uninitiated public. The neophyte is bound over to the most inviolable secrecy as to everything connected with his entrance and further progress in the schools. In Asia, in the same way, the Kila, or pupil of occultism, no sooner becomes a Kila than he ceases to be a witness on behalf of the reality of occult knowledge, says Synod in his great work on esoteric Buddhism. And he then adds, I have been astonished to find, since my own connection with the subject, how numerous such chelas are. But it is impossible to imagine any human act more improbable than the unauthorized revelation by any such chela, to persons in the outer world, that he is one, and so the great esoteric school of philosophy guards its seclusion. Question 3. Does the yogi philosophy teach that there is a place corresponding to the heavens of the various religions? Is there any basis for the belief that there is a place resembling a heaven? Answer: yes, the yogi philosophy does teach that there is a real basis for the popular religious beliefs in heaven, and that there are states of being, the knowledge of which has filtered through to the masses in the more or less distorted theories regarding heavens. But the yogis do not teach that these heavens are places at all. The teaching is that they are planes of existence. It is difficult to explain just what is meant by this word plane. The nearest approach to it in English is the term or word state. A portion of space may be occupied by several planes at the same time, just as a room may be filled with the rays of the sun, those of a lamp, X-rays, magnetic and electric vibrations and waves, etc., each interpenetrating each other and yet not affecting or interfering with each other. On the lower planes of the astral world there are to be found the earthbound souls which have passed out from their former bodies, but which are attracted to the earthly scenes by strong attractions, which serve to weight them down and to prevent them from ascending to the higher planes. On the higher planes are souls that are less bound by earthly attractions, and who, accordingly, are relieved of the weight resulting therefrom. These planes rise in an ascending scale, each plane being higher and more spiritual than the one lower than itself. And dwelling on each plane are the souls fitted to occupy it, by reason of their degree of spiritual development, or evolution. When the soul first leaves the body, it falls into a sleep-like stage, from which it awakens to find itself on the plane for which it is fitted, by reason of its development, attractions, character, etc. The particular plane occupied by each soul is determined by the progress and attainment it has made in its past lives. The souls on the higher planes may, and often do, visit the planes lower in the scale than their own, but those on the lower planes may not visit those higher than their own. Quoting from our own writings on this subject, published several of years ago, we repeat, this prohibition regarding the visiting of higher planes is not an arbitrary rule, but a law of nature. If the student will pardon the commonplace comparison, he may get an understanding of it by imagining a large screen, or series of screens, such as used for sorting coal into sizes. The large coal is caught by the first screen, the next size by the second, and so on until the tiny coal is reached. Now, the large coal cannot get into the receptacle of the smaller sizes, but the small sizes may easily pass through the screen and join the larger sizes, if force be imparted to them. Just so in the astral world, the soul with the greatest amount of materiality and gross nature is stopped by the spiritual screen of a certain plane, and cannot pass on to the higher ones, while other souls have cast off some of the confining and retarding material sheaths, and readily pass on to higher and finer planes. And it may be readily seen that those souls which dwell on the higher planes are able to revisit the lower and grosser planes, while the souls on the grosser cannot penetrate the higher boundaries of their plane, being stopped by the spiritual screen. The comparison is a crude one, but it almost exactly pictures the existing conditions on the spiritual world. Souls on the upper planes may, and often do, journey to the lower planes for the purpose of visiting the souls of friends who may be dwelling there, and thus affording them comfort and consolation. In fact, the teaching is that in many cases a highly developed soul visits souls on the lower planes in whom it is interested, and actually imparts spiritual teaching and instruction to those souls, so that they may be reborn into much better conditions than would have been the case otherwise. All of the planes have spiritual instructors from very high planes, who sacrifice their well-earned rest and happiness on their own planes in order that they may work for the less developed souls on the lower planes. As we have said, the soul awakens on the plane to which it is suited. It finds itself in the company of congenial souls, in whose company it is enabled to pursue those things which were dear to its heart when alive. It may be able to make considerable advancement during its sojourn in heaven, which will result to its benefit when it is reborn on earth. There are countless subplanes, adapted to the infinite requirements of the advancing souls in every degree of development, and each soul finds an opportunity to develop and enjoy to the fullest the highest of which it is capable, and to also perfect itself and to prepare itself for future development, so that it may be reborn under the very best possible conditions and circumstances in the next earth life. But, alas, even in this higher world, all souls do not live up to the best that is in them, and instead of making the best of their opportunities for development, and growing spiritually, they allow the attractions of their material natures to draw them downward, and too often spend much of their time on the planes beneath them, not to help and assist, but to live the less spiritual lives of their friends on the lower planes. In such cases the soul does not reap the benefit of the sojourn in the afterlife, but is born again according to the attractions of its lower, instead of its higher nature, and is compelled to learn its lesson over again. The yogi teachings inform us that the lower planes of the astral world are inhabited by souls of a very gross and degraded type, undeveloped and animal-like. These low souls live out the tendencies and characteristics of their former earth lives, and reincarnate rapidly in order to pursue their material attractions. Of course, there is slowly working even in these undeveloped souls an upward tendency, but it is so slow as to be almost imperceptible. In time these undeveloped souls grow sick and tired of their materiality, and then comes the chance for a slight advance. Of course these undeveloped souls have no access to the higher planes of the astral world, but are confined to their own degraded plane and to the subplanes which separate the astral world from the material world. They cling as closely as possible to the earthly scenes, and are separated from the material world by only a thin screen, if we may use the word. They suffer the tantalizing condition of being within sight and hearing of their old material scenes and environments, and yet unable to manifest on them. These souls form the low class of spirits of which we hear so much in certain circles. They hang around their old scenes of debauchery and sense gratification, and often are able to influence the minds of living persons along the same line and plane of development. For instance, these creatures hover around low saloons and places of ill repute, influencing the sodden brains of living persons to participate in the illicit gratifications of the lower sensual nature. Souls on the higher planes are not bound by these earthly and material attractions, and take advantage of their opportunities to improve themselves and develop spiritually. It is a rule of the astral world that the higher the plane occupied by a soul, the longer the sojourn there between incarnations. A soul on the lowest planes may reincarnate in a very short time, while on the higher planes hundreds and even thousands of years may lapse before the soul is called upon to experience rebirth. But rebirth comes to all who have not passed on to other spheres of life. Sooner or later the soul feels that inward urge toward rebirth and further experience, and becomes drowsy and falls into a state resembling sleep, when it is caught up in the current that is sweeping on toward rebirth, and is gradually carried on to rebirth in conditions chosen by its desires and characteristics, in connection with the operation of the laws of karma. From the soul slumber it passes through what may be called a death on the astral plane, when it is reborn on the earth plane. But, remember this, the soul, when it is reborn on Earth, does not fully awaken from its astral sleep. In infancy and in early childhood, the soul is but slowly awakening, gradually from year to year, the brain being built to accommodate this growth. The rare instances of precocious children and infant genius are cases in which the awakening has been more rapid than ordinary. On the other hand, cases are known where the soul does not awaken as rapidly as the average, and the result is that the person does not show signs of full intellectual activity until nearly middle age. Cases are known when men seemed to wake up when they were 40 years of age, or even later in life, and would then take on a freshened activity and energy, surprising those who had known them before. On some of the planes of the astral world, the souls dwelling there do not seem to realize that they are dead, but act and live as if they were in the flesh. They have a knowledge of the planes beneath them, just as we on Earth know of conditions beneath us, spiritually, but they seem to be in almost absolute ignorance of the planes above them, just as many of us on Earth cannot comprehend the existence of beings more highly developed spiritually than ourselves. This, of course, is only true of the souls who have not been made acquainted with the meaning and nature of life on the astral plane. Those who have acquired this information and knowledge readily understand their condition and profit thereby. It will be seen from this that it is of the greatest importance for persons to become acquainted with the great laws of occultism in their present earth life, for the reason that when they pass out of a body and enter some one of the astral planes, they will not be in ignorance of the condition, but will readily grasp the meaning and nature of their surroundings and take advantage of the same in order to develop themselves more rapidly. It will be seen from what has been written by us here and elsewhere that there are planes after planes on the astral side of life. All that has been dreamt of heaven, purgatory or hell has its correspondence there, although not in the literal sense in which these things have been taught. For instance, a wicked man dying immersed in his desires and longings of his lower nature, and believing that he will be punished in a future life for sins committed on earth, such a one is very apt to awaken on the lower planes or subplanes, in conditions corresponding with his former fears. He finds the fire and brimstone awaiting him, although these things are merely figments of his own imagination, and having no existence in reality. Murderers may roam for ages, apparently, pursued by the bleeding corpses of their victims, until such a horror of the crime arises in the mind that at last, sinking from exhaustion into the soul sleep, their souls pass into rebirth with such a horror of bloodshed and crime as to make them entirely different beings in the new life. And yet the hell that they went through existed only in their imaginations. They were their own devil and hell. Just as a man in earth life may suffer from delirium tremens, so some of these souls on the astral plane suffer agonies from their delirium arising from their former crimes, and the belief in the punishment therefore which has been inculcated in them through earth teachings. And these mental agonies, although terrible, really are for their benefit, for by reason of them the soul becomes so sickened with the thought and idea of crime that when it is finally reborn it manifests a marked repulsion to it, and flies to the opposite. In this connection we would say that the teaching is that although the depraved soul apparently experiences ages of this torment, yet, in reality, there is but the passage of but a short time, the illusion arising from the self-hypnotization of the soul, just as arises the illusion of the punishment itself. In the same way the soul often experiences a heaven in accordance with its hopes, beliefs and longings of earth life. The heaven that it has longed for and believed in during its earth life is very apt to be at least partially reproduced on the astral plane, and the pious soul of any and all religious denominations finds itself in a heaven corresponding to that in which it believed during its earth life. The Mohammedan finds his paradise, the Christian finds his, the Indian finds his, but the impression is merely an illusion created by the mental pictures of the soul. But the illusion tends to give pleasure to the soul, and to satisfy certain longings which in time fade away, leaving the soul free to reach out after higher conceptions and ideals. We cannot devote more space to this subject at this time, and must content ourselves with the above statements and explanations. The principal point that we desire to impress upon your minds is the fact that the heaven world is not a place or state of permanent rest and abode for the disembodied soul, but is merely a place or temporary sojourn between incarnations, and thus serves as a place of rest wherein the soul may gather together its forces, energies, desires and attractions preparatory to rebirth. In this answer we have merely limited ourselves to a general statement of the states and conditions of the astral world, or rather of certain planes of that world. The subject itself requires far more extensive treatment. Question 4. Is nirvana a state of the total extinction of consciousness, and is it a place, state, or condition? Answer. The teaching concerning nirvana, the final goal of the soul, has been much misunderstood, and much error has crept into the teaching even among some very worthy teachers. To conceive of nirvana as a state of extinction of consciousness would be to fall into the error of the pessimistic school of philosophy, which thinks of life and consciousness as a curse, and regards the return into a total unconsciousness as the thing to be most desired. The true teaching is that nirvana is a state of the fullest consciousness, a state in which the soul is relieved of all the illusion of separateness and relativity, and enters into a state of universal consciousness, or absolute awareness, in which it is conscious of infinity, and eternity of all places and things in time. Nirvana, instead of being a state of nothingness, is a state of everythingness. As the soul advances along the path, it becomes more and more aware of its connection with, relation to, and identity with the whole. As it grows, the self enlarges and transcends its former limited bounds. It begins to realize that it is more than the tiny separated atom that it had believed itself to be, and it learns to identify itself in a constantly increasing scale with a universal life. It feels a sense of oneness in a fuller degree, and it sets its feet firmly upon the path toward nirvana. After many weary lives on this and other planets in this and other universes, after it has long since left behind it the scale of humanity, and has advanced into godlike states, its consciousness becomes fuller and fuller, and time and space are transcended in a wonderful manner. And at last the goal is attained, the battle is won, and the soul blossoms into a state of universal consciousness, in which time and place disappear, and in which every place is here, every period of time is now, and everything is I. This is nirvana. Question V. What is that which occultists call an astral shell, or similar name? Is it an entity, or force, or being? Answer. When the soul passes out from the body at the moment of death, it carries with it the astral body as well as the higher mental and spiritual principles. See the first three lessons in the 14 lessons. The astral body is the counterpart of the material or physical body, although it is composed of matter of a much finer and ethereal nature than is the physical body. It is invisible to the ordinary eye, but may be seen clairvoyantly. The astral body rises from the physical body like a faint, luminous vapor, and for a time is connected with the dying physical body by a thin, vapory cord or thread, which finally breaks entirely and the separation becomes complete. The astral body is sometime afterward discarded by the soul as it passes onto the higher planes, as we have described a few pages further back, and the abandoned astral body becomes an astral shell, and is subject to a slow disintegration, just as is the physical body. It is no more the soul than is the physical body. It is merely a cast-off garment of fine matter. It will be seen readily that it is not an entity, force, or being. It is only cast off matter, a slough skin. It has no life or intelligence, but floats around on the lower astral plane until it finally disintegrates. It has an attraction toward its late physical associate, the physical body, and often returns to the place where the latter is buried, where it is sometimes seen by persons whose astral sight is temporarily awakened, when it is mistaken for a ghost or spirit of the person. These astral shells are often seen floating around over graveyards, battlefields, etc., and sometimes these shells, coming in contact with the psychic magnetism of a medium, become galvanized into life, and manifest signs of intelligence, which, however, really comes from the mind of the medium. At some seances, these revitalized shells manifest and materialize, and talk in a vague, meaningless manner, the shell receiving its vitality from the body and mind of the medium instead of speaking from any consciousness of its own. This statement is not to be taken as any denial of true spirit return, but is merely an explanation of certain forms of so-called spiritualistic phenomena, which is well understood by advanced spiritualists, although many seekers after psychic phenomena are in ignorance of it. Question V. What is meant by the days and nights of Brahm, the cycles, the chain of worlds, etc., etc.? Answer. In lesson 6, of the present series, you will find a brief mention of the days and nights of Brahm, those vast periods of the inbreathing and outbreathing of the creative principle, which is personified in the Hindu conception of Brahma. You will see mentioned there the universal philosophical conception of the universal rhythm, which manifests in a succession of periods of universal activity and inactivity. The yogi teachings are that all time is manifested in cycles. Man calls the most common form of cyclic time by the name of a day, which is the period of time necessary for the Earth's revolution on its axis. Each day is a reproduction of all previous days. Although the incidents of each day differ from those of the other, all days are but periods of time marked off by the revolution of the Earth on its axis. And each night is but the negative side of a day, the positive side of which is called day. There is really no such thing as a day, that which we call a day being simply a record of certain physical changes in the Earth's position relating to its own axis. The second phase of cyclic time is called by man by the name of month, by which is meant certain changes in the relative positions of the moon and the earth. The true month consists of 28 lunar days. In this cycle, the month, there is also a light time or day, and a dark time or night, the former being the 14 days of the moon's visibility, and the second being the 14 days of the moon's invisibility. The third phase of cyclic time is that which we call a year, by which is meant the time occupied by the Earth in its revolution around the Sun. You will notice that the year has its positive and negative periods, also known as summer and winter. But the yogis take up the story where the astronomers drop it, at the year. Beyond the year there are other and greater phases of cyclic time. The yogis know many cycles of thousands of years in which there are marked periods of activity and inactivity. We cannot go into detail regarding these various cycles, but may mention another division common to the yogi teachings, beginning with the Great Year. The Great Year is composed of 360 Earth years. 12,000 Great Years constitute what is known as a Great Cycle, which is seen to consist of 4,320,000 Earth years. 70 own Great Cycles compose what is called a Manvantara, at the end of which the Earth becomes submerged under the waters, until not a vestige of land is left uncovered. This state lasts for a period equal to 71 great cycles. A kalpa is composed of 14 manvantaras. The largest and grandest cycle manifested is known as the Maya Pralaya, consisting of 36,000 kalpas, when the Absolute withdraws into itself its entire manifestations, and dwells alone in its awful infinity and oneness. This period being succeeded by a period equally long, the two being known as the days and nights of Brahm. You will notice that each of these great cycles has its day period and its night period, its period of activity, and its period of inactivity. From day to Maya Pralaya, it is a succession of nights and days, creative activity and creative cessation. The chain of worlds is that great group of planets in our own solar system, seven in number, over which the procession of life passes in cycles. From globe to globe, the great wave of soul life passes in cyclic rhythm. After a race has passed a certain number of incarnations upon one planet, it passes on to another, and learns new lessons, and then on and on until finally it has learned all of the lessons possible on this universe, when it passes on to another universe, and so on, from higher to higher, until the human mind is unable to even think of the grandeur of the destiny awaiting each human soul on the path. The various works published by the Theosophical organizations go into detail regarding these matters, which require the space of many volumes to adequately express, but we think that we have at last indicated the general nature of the question, pointing out to the student the nature of the subject, and indicating lines for further study and investigation. Conclusion. And now, dear students, we have reached the end of this series of lessons. You have followed us closely for the past 4 years, many of you having been with us as students from the start. We feel many ties of spiritual relationship binding you to us, and the parting, although but temporary, gives a little pain to us, a little pull upon our heartstrings. We have tried to give to you a plain, practical and simple exposition of the great truths of this world. Old philosophy have endeavored to express in plain simple terms the greatest truths known to man on earth today, the yogi philosophy. And many have written us that our work has not been in vain, and that we have been the means of opening up new worlds of thought to them, and have aided them in casting off the old material sheaths that had bound them for so long, and the discarding of which enabled them to unfold the beautiful blossom of spirituality. Be this as it may, we have been able merely to give you the most elementary instruction in this world philosophy, and are painfully conscious of the small portion of the field that we have tilled, when compared with the infinite expanse of truth still untouched. But such are the limitations of man, he can speak only of that which lies immediately before him, leaving for others the rest of the work which is remote from his place of abode. There are planes upon planes of this truth which every soul among you will someday make his or her own. It is yours, and you will be impelled to reach forth and take that which is intended for you. Be not in too much haste, be of great patience, and all will come to you, for it is your own. Mystic Christianity. We have here to make an announcement that will please our readers, judging from the many letters that we have received during the several of years of our work. We will now enter upon a new phase of our work of presenting the great truths underlying life, as taught by the great minds of centuries ago, and carefully transmitted from master to student from that time unto our own. We have concluded our presentation of the mystic teachings underlying the Hindu philosophies, and shall now pass on to a consideration and presentation of the great mystic principles underlying the great and glorious creed of the Western world, the religion, teachings, and philosophy of Jesus the Christ. These teachings, too, as we should remember, are essentially Eastern in their origin and source, although their effects are more pronounced in the Western world. Underlying the teaching and philosophy of the Christ are to be found the same esoteric principles that underlie the other great systems of philosophies of the East. Covered up though the truth be by the additions of the Western churches and sects, still it remains there burning brightly as ever, and plainly visible to one who will brush aside the rubbish surrounding the sacred flame and who will seek beneath the forms and non-essentials for the mystic truths underlying Christianity. We realize the importance of the work before us, but we shrink not from the task, for we know that when the bright light of the Spirit, which is found as the center of the Christian philosophy, is uncovered, there will be great rejoicing from the many who, while believing in and realizing the value of the Eastern teachings, still rightly hold their love, devotion and admiration for him who was in very truth the Son of God, and whose mission was to raise the world spiritually from the material quagmire into which it was stumbling. And now, dear pupils, we must close this series of lessons on the yogi philosophy. We must rest ere we so soon engage upon our new and great work. We must each take a little rest, ere we meet again on the path of attainment. Each of these temporary partings are milestones upon our journey of spiritual life. Let each find us farther advanced. And now we send you our wishes of peace. May the peace be with you all, now and forever, even unto Nirvana, which is peace itself.